I'd like to introduce you to Ruth Gay. Ruth has served as the Chief Public Policy Officer for the Alzheimer's Association of Northern California and Northern Nevada for the past 20 years. And she has just recently been promoted as the Senior Director of Field Operations for our National Public Policy Division. She's an expert on the issues of policy gaps in service delivery for people with Alzheimer's disease and related dementia. Ruth directs the federal policy and advocacy strategic activities for the chapter and currently oversees the policy efforts for Nevada, California, Hawaii, and Arizona. She is a leader in the development of nationwide strategies to address Alzheimer's disease. Please join me in welcoming Ruth Gay.
Thank you, Stephen. And thanks for having me here today. I'm really excited to be here. So let me talk a little bit about what's happening from a policy standpoint. You know, I think I love the presentation earlier and where we're going with research. And I have to say how intertwined policy and research have to be. There's politics in research funding. There are many avenues that can be invested in, and I think Alzheimer's disease is on the cutting edge right now. We were just talking about this a few minutes ago, where the brain is sort of the last frontier. It's what we really don't understand very well. And how do we begin to take those things we're learning about a disease and turn it into political action that allows people across the country to be helped by these assets? So let's talk a little bit about what we've been doing with Alzheimer's disease, I hope. So first of all, why advocacy? And I don't know if this will play without. The magnitude of this disease, sixth leading cause of death in the United States, probably second leading cause of death in California. What we really need to do is find treatment options that are viable. So let me tell you a little bit about where we're going and what we've been working on. In 2012, our national government passed unanimously, believe it or not, a national plan to defeat Alzheimer's disease with two key overarching treatments. A disease-altering treatment by 2025, that's coming right up, and $2 billion in research funding by that time period. At that time, research funding for Alzheimer's disease was at ridiculously low levels. It was almost orphan status, $443 million, something like that. It didn't touch the tip of the iceberg in terms of the way we needed to use funding to improve care and support and research for people with Alzheimer's disease. And what we ran into when we were working with legislators to increase research funding for Alzheimer's disease was sort of a, hey, you know what, I think this is a good idea. But you know what, we don't like to tell the scientists what to do. The scientists know where they should put the money, and all you need to do is just, you know, have them start allocating money. So then we went to the NIH, and we said to the NIH, hey, you guys, how come cancer and heart disease and HIV/AIDS are in the billions of dollars,
and Alzheimer's disease is a blip on the screen. And they said, hey, we're really sorry, but we get a budget. Congress gives us a budget every year. What else can we do? And so we said, okay, let's do something about this. So we passed a law in 2016 that said, that required the National Institutes of Health, if they were going to reach that $2 billion goal and develop a disease-altering treatment by 2025, how much money could they manage each year to begin to scale this up and begin to do more funding, more research at a higher level at an accelerated pace? And so the bill required the NIH to submit directly to Congress their budget, and it required Congress to act on that and act specifically on that request. That bill passed in 1 year, and that very first year, we got an additional $400 million in research funding. In 2018, it was $414 million additional dollars. By 2019, it was a $425 million increase in research funding. And our request this coming fiscal year is for an additional $350 million. If you look at where we are today with research funding at $2.3 billion, we're starting to really fund real progress in Alzheimer's research. And we still have more to go. But let's... How's that? Okay. Sorry, you guys. So that was our first major progression of beginning to increase research funding and make a difference towards a disease-altering treatment. Next, we wanted to look at what happens to people with diagnosis. You all know that many people have a hard time getting diagnosed. Half the people in our country today don't ever get a diagnosis. They never know what it is they're dealing with. So how do we begin to change that? And in 2016, Medicare adopted, with our encouragement, a package reimbursement for doctors that if they will diagnose, put it in the medical record, and provide care planning, they get a higher reimbursement for managing care for people with Alzheimer's disease. That was a temporary code in Medicare in 2017, and it was a permanent code in 2018. It is on the books, and we had overwhelming bipartisan support for that, and Medicare adopted that without us even having to require it. So we know that as we begin to make inroads in these areas, we really have to improve the way people are served. As I said to you, we know that many people never get diagnosed, and we know that many of those people, even if the diagnosis is in their record, that they are never told of the diagnosis. People don't want to have that conversation with people. The percent of seniors with Alzheimer's disease that are diagnosed who are aware of their condition is remarkably low. And that's unacceptable. That's unacceptable for any disease. It's not okay. You know, 60 years ago, that was how we treated people with cancer. Don't say anything. They'll just get depressed. Let's do something about this. So when we talk about the needs for care planning, we know that care planning is key. I was talking to a family just the other day, and Grandpa clearly is confused. He can't get up to fix a meal. He doesn't know how to ask for help. He can't get to the bathroom on his own. And he also cognitively doesn't always remember who people are. And the family said to me, yeah, but he doesn't have dementia. He doesn't have anything like that. Right? We don't really have that. It's remarkable that how long you can stumble along without realizing, one, what you're dealing with, and number two, even if you're not sure what you're dealing with, a care plan can help you put some things in place that make a difference for your family, for a very long time, and it's cost effective as well. So what we found, though, in the last 2.5 years since this coding has been available is that the number of doctors actually drawing down this code is about 1%. I said, well, at least it's not zero, I guess. So our next step, and this year that we're working on, is an improving HOPE for Alzheimer's Act, where Medicare is now going to be required to document what docs, train doctors on how to use this code, provide information for providers and find out where the barriers are for their use of this code and make a report to Congress every year. This is moving forward right now, and we actually will have a, if any of you are on our advocacy list, we're having a electronic lobby day on Monday where we're asking people to text to their legislators and ask them to pass this out of committee. This is an important area, and having CMS play a role in advancing understanding by providers of the importance of this is critical. We're also looking at younger onset Alzheimer's disease. We know that there are at least 200,000 people with younger onset Alzheimer's disease in this country today, and their needs are unique, and their needs are different than those folks that are older with the disease. It's not that it's not a terrible, but those they have some unique challenges. We need to begin to address this in meaningful ways, and one of the things that we're looking at right now is with the reauthorization of the Older Americans Act, which is going forward right now, could we include services for people with younger onset Alzheimer's disease? Meals on Wheels, transportation services, help with care and support, all of those things that might be delivered through a senior center or a community agency, would those be available to these folks in these circumstances? And that's something we're working on right now. And the political climate. You know and I know that Alzheimer's disease is not blue and it's not red. It's purple. And we cannot afford to have any one party the owner of issues on Alzheimer's disease. We have to have champions on both sides of the aisle, and we have to advance these efforts irregardless of who's at the helm and who's the dominant party. The big changing role that we're beginning to look at from a policy perspective is what's the role of public health in addressing the disparities that occur with Alzheimer's disease? Public health promotes and protects at the community level. The parts that make public health a very viable usage for people with Alzheimer's disease is the burden is large. You saw the numbers, the number of people, the impact, the cost is profound. The impact is major. And there are ways to intervene. How do we begin to do that effectively and across the country, not one provider by provider by provider? We have to do this on a larger scale, and we have to do it more quickly. So last year, 2018, you may remember, we introduced an act called the BOLD Act. Some of you may have heard of this, but the BOLD Act was the first time ever we were asking the Centers for Disease Control to fund state public health departments to develop centers of excellence, places where people can get diagnosis or treatment options and providers are given information, and we can collect data at the state level to improve care for Alzheimer's disease. Last year, in 2018, there were 1,600 bills introduced that year. You may remember that there were a few things going on, like government shutdowns, remember that, where there was a little bit of arguing around that kind of thing? And at the end of the year, 25 bills came out of that 1,600. I mean, 100 bills came out of that 1,600, and the BOLD Act was one of them. And in the very end of the year, on December 31st, President Trump signed one of the last 25 bills into law, and it was the Bold Act. And what I'll say to you is, when that bill was signed into law, it's profoundly shocking to think that it made it so far, and the importance of it is without, we don't even know yet how far it will take us. We know that Alzheimer's disease needs to be a prevalence, treated at the prevalence level that it needs to be addressed. I'll tell you that we've been working some with the public health departments in the state of Nevada right now, and they said to us, our folks don't have dementia expertise. We need more dementia expertise if we're going to advance things like centers of excellence. We want to be a center of excellence. How does that happen? Especially in rural communities. So now we have the opportunity to hold out these options to state public health departments to help them grow and be funded to do so, in the same way that they work on diseases like diabetes and smoking cessation and vaping and all the other areas of public awareness that public health engages in. We want public health to begin to address the issues around early detection and diagnosis. Providers have to be more comfortable with it. People with the disease have to know to ask for it. Families need to know what the warning signs are. All of those things have to happen at the same time. We also know that every voice makes a difference. We know that when our constituents, our families, our community members, our folks that have been touched by this disease, develop relationships with their members, we turn legislators without information into champions for us. And that is why research funding is now at $2.3 billion. That is why the HOPE Act is in play, and we're actually able to expand on what that might mean. That's why Alzheimer's disease is now beginning to be on the lips of public health professionals across the country. We can make a difference, and it's about having our legislators be engaged at every step of the way. So thank you all very much, and I'm going to turn it over to our next speaker.